Okay. Hey, welcome to the Spider Pop Arcade. I'm Gordon. We're starting this as soon as we possibly can, because
we're on short time. I want to finish this today, but goddammit.
I'm here with Blanc and Magpie as per usual. So, what happened last time?
We would be fine, but Blanc has work.
We both have work, yeah. And they've been giving us conflicting schedules, and it's bullshit.
I thought you were off today.
I am, but he's not. And then I don't know if they're going to keep my schedule next week. Like, sometimes I'll ask for, like, oh, can I have Monday and Friday off? And they're like, cool. And then they'll give it to me next week, and it's like, no, that was just the one thing. But give me back my two consecutive days, please. Okay, so what happened last time? We're trying to get on the train. The train's going to get us the fuck out of here, and we ran into Jenna. Also,
oh, we missed the train.
Yeah, we missed the train. But they said it comes by randomly, so we'll probably see another one. Also, yeah. I could see my chat box is a bit out of alignment. I'll have to fix that later. Anyway, let's get the show on the road. Ooh. Okay, so we found her, and she's like, she's ready to fucking swing, y'all.
Yeah, something's on top of Kudzu.
She got
she's
the hysteria.
Be right now.
She got the echo hysteria. Okay. The heap is Kudzu, and he's got his arms up in self-defense, snarling back, his eyes wide. Jenna! Just like that, the snarl drops from her face and her eyes snap up to mine. Chase? But then the position is suddenly reversed as Kudzu grabs the fox by the wrist and practically barrel rolls. Now Kudzu sits on her as he keeps a hold on her wrist. Wait, stop! I rush over to them, grabbing Kudzu's upper arm, trying to pull him away from Jenna. It's okay, she's good, she recognizes me. Kudzu only hesitates for a moment before scrambling off the fox and backing away, breathing hard. Jenna quickly sits up absentmindedly, brushing off her shirt as she looks up at me. Oh my god, okay, Chase.
One second.
What's going on? Oh, right. He's got food.
He got food.
Okay, so that's happening. Oh, damn it, if I click. Oh, wait, I have my phone right here. Which I should probably. Okay, it is still silent. It's good.
Ow. Jesus.
You okay? The plate a little hot. Okay, nothing important here. All right, well, we good?
I'm back.
Okay.
Yeah, that plate
okay.
was warm.
She's snapping out of it. She says it in a hushed whisper, putting a paw to her mouth. Jenna, are you okay? I reach down to help her up, and she immediately goes in to hug me. I stand there awkwardly for a moment. She buries her face into my shoulder, gasping for breath. I'm not sure if she's crying or not. Are you okay? Ask her again, patting her back awkwardly. Sorry, I'm fine. Oh, I've never seen her make this face before.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, that's comforting. Jenna steps back and wipes under her eye with the back of her paw. I know where any of you were. Where were you? Jenna looks all right for the most part, except for a bunch of dirt on her clothes and in her fur. But then I don't know if that's from before or after she was wrestling Kudzu. I don't know. I was just in the desert and... It's still dark, obviously, but I can make out the frown on her face as she seems to struggle for words. Finally, Kudzu steps in. Hey, let's get to my...
Hey, let's go to my trailer. We'll talk it out in there, all right?
Jenna silently nods and seems to really focus on Kudzu. Wait, who are you? I step in for the raccoon. This is Kudzu. He's a friend. He saved me a bunch of times. This seems to be good enough for Jenna. Out of the way, we all head back toward the trailer. Quietly, Kudzu lets the... Oh, the song's playing again.
They're all split up. We gotta find the others again.
I know. Quietly, Kudzu lets us into his trailer, opening the screen door slowly so that it doesn't creak. He motions us inside, and Jenna follows in behind me, pressing close. I suppose she has a good reason to be wary of this place. She doesn't really know Kudzu at this point, and it's hard to even trust people that you do know. Kudzu closes the door and slides the locks in place. Jenna stands next to me in the small living room area, arms folded tightly across her body like she's hugging herself. Hey, you want to sit down? We just sit at the recliner, which Jenna stares at for a few seconds. I don't know. The fox's ears are twitching around and pointed straight up. I turn the small love seat against the wall instead. Maybe there? I can sit with you. After a few moments of staring at the couch, Jenna finally nods. She walks stiffly over to the couch, looking at it for a moment before finally sitting down. I notice three cunt patches in front of the back of her neck, and it takes me a moment to realize that it's dried blood. It's Someone attacked her? Did she hurt herself? Anastelle doesn't relax when we're settled and is instead of that bolt up tight, leaning hard against upright. My shoulder. Oh, upright, sorry. Much like her ears, her eyes are darting around, mostly over the curtain window to our right. Meanwhile, Kudzu elects to sit in the empty recliner after turning it a little to face us. After scraping sound it makes on the floor causes Jenna to jump. Kudzu pauses, blinking, and then settles back in the recliner. Sorry,
I really shouldn't put a rug under this thing, huh?
Jenna doesn't say anything and instead just looks back at the window. Kudzu shifts awkwardly in the chair, then looks at me. Look at Jenna trying to think of something to say. Jenna beats me to it. You know where the others are? TJ or Carl? Oh, yeah. Yeah, they're at Leo's place. Them and Leo. Jenna frowns at me. Then why are we here? Let's go. She starts to stand up, but I reach a paw, grabbing her arm. She flinches and yanks away from me, standing up fully. Sorry, just hold on a second. It's complicated. Why? Jenna takes a step back from me, folding her arms. The look in her eyes is worrying, like she's starting to not trust me. Look, Leo, he's kind of uptight right now. I guess I just wanted to give him some space. Give myself some space. Really away from him. Far away from him. Kudzu shifts his chair again. He kicked me out.
Things got a little heated between us.
And it looks at Kudzu, the deep frown still on her face. Why? Leo wouldn't do that without reason. She looks back at me as if wanting some sort of confirmation. I nod. Leo isn't really himself right now. I'm really worried about him. Can we go over there and talk to him? I open my mouth and I pause, trying to think of the right way to say it. I don't know. Not right now. I'm not leaving Kudzu, so I'm going to have to think of a way to get Leo to calm down. I'm also considering just staying separate from him until we can get out of here, but I don't want to tell Jenna that. She looks stressed out enough as it is. Now that I think about it, would be surprised if Leo is out there hunting for me right now. Odds are that he's going to come here eventually, maybe. Maybe he jumped the train already? That reminds me, though. Oh, yeah, we think we found a way out. Really? Yeah, apparently a train goes through here once in a while. We're thinking we could hitch a ride on it. Jenna takes that in and then just nods. The silence drags out for a minute or two before I finally lean towards her again. It's okay. Just sit down and relax for a minute. She does so with even more hesitance than the first time, sitting on the couch cushion like it might be a landmine. So, where were you these past few days? If you want to tell me, I mean. Jenna stares at the floor, then shrugs. I don't really know. It's kind of a blur. I nod. Yeah, same. I guess it happened 2 or 3 days ago. I don't remember, but everything was normal until TJ woke up. It was like he was in a trance or something. I wasn't sure what was wrong with him. I thought he might have been having a seizure. Then I thought he was in a psychosis of some kind. He left the motel and started running, so I followed and all the way to the lake, and I was sure he was going to go in, but then he just stopped on the shore and stared at it. Caught up with him and tried to talk to him, but it was like I wasn't there. All he could say was your name. Chase. Chase, where's Chase? I think he was looking in the water for you. Jenna looks right at me. I don't know why, do you? Oh, is that the one? Is this
yeah, it's the one.
Okay.
This voice from now on, yeah.
Apparently this text has a sound. Oh, sweet, I still have it on my phone. Okay.
Of course not.
I shake my head. I have no idea.
Liar.
The couch tilts. And so I'm sort of grabbed, and so I grabbed his shoulder and led him back away from the lake. But then he turned on me and he sort of just changed.
The water changed that day.
My head spins and I brace my paw against the armrest, trying not to fall over. And he attacked me, clawed me up.
And for the first time?
Jenna sticks out her arm and pulls back some of the fur where I see bits of crusted blood.
He knew what the water felt like.
I had to run from him and he chased me for a while.
to everyone else?
And as I did, I realized the whole town was different. Everyone was different.
Suffocating.
I swallow hard, still gripping on the couch, but Jenna doesn't seem to notice and Kutsu's looking at her. The humming in my head has finally starts to die down. You say he's at Leo's? Is he okay? Did he explain what happened? I shake my head, but only a little. I feel like I'm going to throw up. No, but he has been acting a little strange, I guess. I need to talk to him, make sure he's actually okay. We will, though I'm not sure that she'll find him okay at all. So what happened?
So what happened after all of that? It looks like you were hiding out there.
She gestures a paw at the window. Jenna covers her face with both paws, sighing deeply. That I'm not too sure about. After I ran, it all just sort of became a dream. I only remember bits and pieces. We wait a moment for Jenna seems to think. I remember I went back to the motel, I think, but I saw nothing. Jenna pauses, then lets out a little humorous laugh. A thing that I remember from my childhood. A monster, I guess.
A monster?
Yeah, like this thing. Jenna waves her paw in front of her face. Had a red face, and I don't know, I thought I saw it in my closet a few times as a kid. Felt like it was chasing me.
What do you think it was?
Jenna laughs hollowly again. Oh, I don't think it's anything. I must have my own little breakdown after seeing everyone else's. I sighs deeply again, sitting in the back. The thing we saw was white, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, God, that means there's more than one. Ah! But then you guys came along now, and I think everything is clear. Jenna leans back for a moment, breathing deeply, and for the first time, it seems like she's relaxing a bit. She turns her attention to Kudzu. Hey, Kudzu, is it? Kudzu nods. What if I use your restroom? I just need a moment to collect myself and pee too. An actual toilet would be nice.
Oh, right. Yeah, just right there.
Kudzu points at a thin little white door between the kitchen and the living area. Thanks. And with that, Jenna disappears into the bathroom. Kudzu and I sit in silence for a moment, listening to the sound of running water from the faucet. I think we have a reason to go back to Leo's house. I know he won't be mad at you if he knows you found Jenna.
I don't know about that. But yes, we're going to have to go back with her.
I'll talk to him first, in case he's still out of it.
Again, thanks. I'm glad you're here with me right now.
Likewise. Kudzu rubs his arm awkwardly.
I get panicky when things get physical, which they have a lot lately.
Oh my god. I hope we could date you. I gesture at the cushion next to me, and after a moment of hesitation, Kudzu gets up to the recliner and sits next to me. God, I hope Leo isn't watching. This fucking breaks through the fucking window.
Too late, man's his way in.
I reach around him and squeeze him to my side. That's cool. Like I said, he saved my ass so many times. At this point, it's the least I could do. I almost tell him that he's been there for me more than anyone at this point. It feels like a bit too much right now. That's probably a good idea. Kutsu chuckles and leans back, his arm brushing mine. I didn't know it used to be like this,
you know?
What?
I fucking cowered.
He's the bravest fucker here! Are you kidding me? I scrunched my muzzle up. What? No way, you've been insanely brave. Kutsu shakes his head.
Nah, you should have seen me at Duke's house when you got caught, and then down in the basement when Leo tossed me out.
Those are all great reasons to have been scared, Kutsu. You still faced all of it. Kutsu looks unconvinced.
I don't know, Chase. After what Leo did, I don't think I was gonna come back.
I shrug. Well, then, I'm glad I came after you, then. Kutsu's quiet for a moment. Then he chuckles quietly, leaning his head back to stare at the ceiling. What?
Just, I moved to Echo to get away from stuff like this.
He shakes his head.
Now look at what's happened. It's fucking ridiculous.
Like, people going crazy?
That and the guns and violence. Peyton is in a rough city compared to others in this country, but it has rough patches. And I lived in one of those patches.
Oh, fuck. I think you told me that you moved here because there's less people. You decide quietly.
It's not the only reason. I lost someone a few years back. I need a fresh start, I guess.
Oh, God. Why does everyone have a dead friend?
Didn't we know this already? I feel like this got brought up before.
We knew that he lost someone. Yeah, we know that he lost someone. It's just I'm forgotten remembering now. The sound starts out for a moment as I contemplate that. My eyes drift to the picture frames by the love seat to one where someone had their arm around Kutsu. In it, I see a hare, smiling just as toothy as the raccoon next to him, a good head taller than his companion.
Mm-hmm. But now look around.
I step my eyes back to the raccoon, not wanting to be caught looking. I don't know what to say, so I just settle with, we're going to get out. Just gotta listen for that train.
Mm-hmm.
Sue has his eyes closed, so I lean back too. Despite all the shit going on outside, there's something really peaceful about being here next to Kutsu in his neat little trailer. We sit here for a while listening to the soft rush of running water. After a while, I look toward the bathroom, realizing how uncomfortably full my bladder is right now. Jenna doesn't seem to be coming out anytime soon, though. Listen, I gotta take a piss.
Again?
This smirks at me. Oh, yeah, it's been a few hours. I pee a lot anyway. God, so do I. Yeah. I drink so much water.
Very good to know.
Yeah, I'll be right back. His joking demeanor suddenly drops.
I don't know. I think we should stick together right now. Remember what happened last time?
You want to catch me?
This was my suggestion.
He has the subtlest blush under his mask. I fucking love it. Kutsu pauses.
I'll stand in the doorway, all right? Just go by the side of the trailer.
All right. Head back out while Kutsu hangs back by the door.
Just make it quick and again, yell if something happens.
It's fine, I'll be only a few feet away. I had a small smile at how motherly Kutsu's being right now. After everything that's happened, it's no wonder. I move around the side of the trailer back into the darkness. Quickly, I unbutton, zip down my fly, I start to go when I hear footsteps behind me over my shoulder. Kutsu, what? And then two massive oh, no.
No, goddammit.
I don't get a glimpse of thick claws and brown matted fur.
Oh, no. It's totally Ryan, yeah.
Oh, shit. I scream and I'm pulled back into the dark toward the desert. I know who it is immediately. The smell is unmistakable. That and the high-pitched voice cursing as he drags me along the brush. Fucking hell! Kutsu's scream seems like it's only a few yards away. He's going to catch up to us and I don't know what. I try to fight Brian off, I guess, but just as I'm thinking about that, Brian picks me up off the ground and practically throws me. Next thing I know, my head. Damn it, why is it always the head? Next thing, something hard. Probably a fucking rock. There's so many of them in this goddamn city. My legs are all splayed upwards. My foot pads pressed against something smooth and cool. I hear more cursing and the sound of snarling. Kutsu? I hear the sound of a car door slam, and I realize I'm in a truck, my feet pressed against the windshield. Brian's massive bulk squeezes in next to me, and I feel the truck accelerate. The backside wobbles back and forth in the sand as it tries to find purchase in the ground. When we find the road, I'm pressed back in the seat as Brian steps on the gas. I scramble right into the seated position, pressing back as far as I can against the door away from Brian. He doesn't seem to be paying attention to me right now. His eyes fixed on the road. My heart hammers in my chest. I can't even start to comprehend what just happened to me. Is this real? Am I dreaming? How did I end up fucking how did I end up fucking things so badly again? Brent takes a hard turn and I almost tumble into him. In a panic, I kick my feet against his side, keeping myself upright against the door. The big bear grunts and glances at me before fixing his eyes back to the road. I quickly draw my feet back, pressing my knees against my chest as I try to hold to the chair and keep from falling over. I realize that Brian must have been waiting for me, waiting outside Kutsu's trailer for a perfect moment to grab me. I'd given it to him idiotically, skipping outside to take a piss, the result of which I could smell wafting from my pants. I don't care though, everything's numb right now, and my mind is racing trying to figure out how I'm gonna get out of this. My pod, just tell Leo, it'll be fine. He'll catch up to the truck and fucking rip his head off. I'll be like, hey, thanks. I'm not coming back here and we should see other people. My paw automatically reaches back to pull at the door handle. It's locked. My paw feels along the door looking for the lock. My fingers pass over a small hole where I assume it should be, but it's smooth. It's like the little nub for the pop-up lock is missing or that it's been cut off. Swallowing hard, I keep searching my fingers to come across the window crank handle. definitely start to roll it down, but it's clear that I haven't thought ahead as Brian immediately notices the drafty air. He lunges at me, one hand still on the wheel. I scream and dodge out the way, falling into the footwell as I try to escape his massive paws. He doesn't grab me, instead reaching for the handle, rolling the window back up. Is he going to try to feed me to the monster? The truck swerves back and forth as he does for a moment. I'm sure he's about to roll the whole thing with how fast we're going. Aw, man, what if he caught up with... Wait, no, Duke's dead on the highway. I forgot about that.
Yeah.
He finally sits upright again. Do that again and I'll knock you out. And still doesn't look at me. It's only then that I notice a stark difference in his demeanor has now compared to the first few times I'd seen him. There's no lust, no animalistic drive to fuck everything around him. Instead, there's a sort of desperation about him. I see his eyes dart around in the glow of the headlights, the fur all over his face matted down from sweat, and probably blood. I sit there in the footwell, staring up at him, gripping onto the seat as my head knocks back against the glove compartment. After a few minutes of erratic driving and swerving, I gather my wits enough to speak. What are you doing? Ren's eyes flick down toward me and then back up to the road before he shakes his head. He does it slowly, like he can't believe something, but he doesn't say anything, at least not for a while. Then after what could have been anywhere from 2 minutes to 20 minutes, he speaks.
Can you tell me the truth, boy?
I sit there quietly contemplating making a jump for his door to open and tumble out into the desert. If I wasn't injured badly enough or even survived for that matter, maybe I could make a run for it. What truth?
What's going on in this town?
Oh my god. Excuse my eyes shut and let my forehead thump against the seat, but only for a moment since I want to be able to keep an eye on Brian. I already told Duke, I have no fucking clue. You were there. Brian grunts as he continues to stare out the windshield, clearly thinking about something. I can't help you or anyone here, Brian. I'm just trying to find a way out. That gives me an idea. Wait, I actually might know a way to get out of here. If you let me go, I'll tell you. As soon as that comes out of my mouth, I wonder if I've made a mistake. Bren doesn't need to let me go to get me to tell him what he wants. I'm alone here with him, and he can do whatever he wants to me. And I'd probably tell him whatever he wanted to hear. But he surprises me and says what he thinks escaping isn't going to fix any of this. We're all still going to see the same shit. I wait, but he stays quiet. It takes me another minute to work up the courage to ask. See what? No, exactly what? He screeches at me in this high-pitched voice, and the truck swerves precariously. I can imagine the tire sliding off the road for a moment before Brian corrects it.
You know exactly what I'm talking about.
He says more gently, taking deep breaths to calm himself. He then looks down at me. It's all a hard wanting to find the right answer, but unsure what this might be. Please tell me you fucking know something! Like, when Duke saw something on the ceiling in the diner, that's the first thing that comes to mind. It's something that Brian saw with me. He lets out the cold guffaw.
That's exactly what I'm talking about, Otter. That and every fucking thing else.
The truck takes another hard turn and I brace myself in the little well. The swerves and turns are becoming more frequent. I can't really see out the window, but I'm pretty sure we're headed into the mountains. Oh, no. Was that creature thing going to attack us? Should I warn Brian?
We've all been seeing shit for a long time. Even before this crazier shit started a few days back.
Brian glances down at me once again.
Haven't seen stuff here.
My mind immediately thinks back to when I was a kid. I'd seen plenty of things, plenty of horrible things. But the psychiatrist had said that was normal, that sometimes kids hallucinate. I notice that Brian's not wearing his seatbelt, and I start to toy with the idea of grabbing the wheel. Again, I might be killed.
Is that the most egregious thing going on right now?
I know, right? It would at least stop Brian from taking me to wherever he's taking me.
Being kidnapped, but worrying about road safety laws.
It might even be better to die. Maybe, but my parents, my friends, they haven't really seen stuff. Except Jenna. And now TJ and Carl after all this started. Brian grins the crook with his crooked and missing teeth.
Seems we only see shit if there's a reason to. I don't know what it is either, but from what I've seen, it's a combination of a shitty experience and being an echo.
The truck is slowing down a little now as we start taking sharper turns. Brian's calmed down at least, but it also means that we're definitely in the deep mountains at this point, the road having turned to gravel. I was a kid in pain. I didn't see shit. Even though I was, though I had a pretty fucked up childhood. Well, I'm left when I was 6 because my dad was a piece of shit. But you know, she's a piece of shit for leaving me with him. Anyway, you know where my dad told me she'd gone? I don't say anything until Brian looks down at me expectantly. Where? Brian cackles. I sense a chill up my spine. The aliens have taken her. I press myself deeper into the well, wishing I could just disappear into the floor. I think he must have been drunk or high, or both. But it stuck with me, you know? I nod, trying to keep the bear happy as he drives along the road so curvy it seems impossible in my mind. Then, when I was a teenager, 87 or so, I got myself a boyfriend. More of a fuck buddy. We kind of hated each other. He talked too much, and he was a good fuck, and the only faggot I knew. So I came here every other week or so to fuck him. But then, something weird happened on my second or third trip out here. I remember the moon was red that night because the forest fires out west. And I kept looking at it, and that's when I saw a flying saucer. Like one straight out of a cartoon with lights and the dome thing on top. I couldn't believe it. But there it fucking was, floating through the sky. And you know, even though it looked stupid as fuck, I knew. Man takes a wide turn and the truck slows more and more until it becomes comes to a rumbling halt. My ears ring in the silence as Brian continues to stare out into the night, the headlights lighting up his face. It knew I saw it, and it was fucking evil. I just knew it. Brian looks down at me again. That night, and almost every night after, I'd wake up and couldn't move, and aliens would be around my bed. There was this one alien that I knew was my mom. She didn't look like my mom. She looked like an alien, but I just knew it was her. She'd do these things to me, sometimes to my mouth, eyes, and nose, but usually to my dick, torture me, and it felt fucking real. Brian chuckles, still staring at me. Fucked me up good, and I blamed my boyfriend for it, for bringing me to Echo because I was sure that's where the evil came from. I outed him that year, and he had to leave town because of it. The massive bear shakes his head. Didn't stop the dreams, though. Baron puts the truck in park and shuts off the engine. We sit in the darkness and silence, and even though I just emptied my bladder, I feel like I'm gonna piss myself again. Never told anyone that before. I don't say anything, as I just breathe through my mouth, trying to make as little sound as possible. There's something fucked up in this town that makes us see things, feel things from our past or some shit. Duke told me about it, how it's been happening a long fucking time, but he thinks there's a way to fix it. Baron suddenly opens the door and jumps out. He slams the door hard enough to make my ears pop. For about 5 seconds, I will myself to move, to run, to open the door and sprint into the night, but my body refuses to move, and before I know it, the bear's yanking my door and grabbing me by the wrist. You help me out with this. We can be done with it for good. He pulls me out roughly. My legs are like rubber when he sets me on the ground, but he holds me up easily with his paws on my arms. I promise to help. Then I'll let you go and you'll be free from the evil, okay? All I can do is nod dumbly. All right. It's gonna be okay, Otter, I promise. Brian transfers his iron-like grip to my wrist and starts to pull me along. I stumble after him weakly, trying not to trip in the darkness. Brian stops next to the truck and starts to rummage around inside. I feel like I'm going to pee again. What do you need me to do? Brian finally pulls something out and it looks shiny and heavy. Oh no. Open my mouth and scream, but that's when a burst of light comes out of one end of it. It's a mag light. A mag light? Like a flashlight?
I think so, maybe.
Yeah, no, that's a flashlight. I stare at it, gaping stupidly. Yeah, I thought it was going to be like a fucking shotgun or something. Brian sweeps the beam of light around. All around us is gravel, sagebrush, and some cacti. I have no idea where we are. I need to get something. It's in a place that's too small for me to squeeze into. I need your help to get it, okay? Okay, but what is it? Brian ignores me looking around. He seems to settle on a direction and sets off pulling me along with him. Anyway.
makes me think all these ghosts and UFOs and monsters people see in the woods, I think they're all connected somehow.
Yeah? A focus on trying to keep the bear happy, pretending to keep to be interested in his ramblings. Meanwhile, we're not even on a trail, just pushing through thick brush and sharp rocks. Yeah, like little bits of echo are everywhere in the world. Some small like a house, some huge like a town. That makes sense.
No, it doesn't.
None of this makes sense. But I have to focus on getting away from the bear. I know I should move and... I know I should have made a run for it back in the car, but there's no helping that now. Also, he should have a fucking bullet hole right here.
There is. It's on his nose.
Oh, it's on his nose.
Yeah.
Oh, I thought we got him in, like, between the eyes.
No, well, yeah. Well, I kind of assumed it was on the bridge of his nose, but it's...
Okay. That's still in between the eye area.
Right back in a second.
Oh. All right. We walked for maybe about 100 yards. Let's see. I'll wait for Megs in the meantime. Because we've all gotten invested in this. God almighty.
I am tempted to call off. I am so tempted.
I mean, I can't make you, but also, like, yeah, no, you shouldn't do that early. Or that late, I should say, because you always need 2 hours before to do that, and I don't want to piss off your mom. Mm. Oh, God. This is a good time to stretch.
Also, maybe turn off my phone and conserve some battery power.
And I'm back.
Okay, cool. Oh, hold on. I moved my jaw in an odd position, and then it almost started to cramp up. Okay, we walk for maybe about 100 yards. As we do, the land starts to incline and become steep. Brian even slips a few times, and I'm worried he's going to fall on top of me. Each time he manages to catch himself, then yank me up after him. After a few minutes of huffing and puffing, we reach a bit of outcrop with some large boulders. Brian lets go of me and clambers up the side of one, and before I can even think of running, he turned around and grabbed me by the scruff. I squeak as I'm lifted into the air, feeling like a pup again, before I'm set down beside the bear. Brian looks around, keeping a hold of my wrist as he does. After some stomping and looking around with his flashlight, he seems to find what he's looking for. He brings us to the edge of a boulder, then he lifts me up again, this time by the waist. Pick around from him before he lowers me slowly into a dark, spacious hole, and I start to wonder if it's going to go down for a while, and I panic before my feet touch the soft, cold dirt. Musty, cold air wafts from the black space in front of me. Immediately, Brian drops down next to me, snatching up my paw again. He shines the light into the dark patch in front of me, and I see what looks like a narrow tunnel burrowing into the...
We're in the mines, aren't we?
Yeah.
We're in the mines.
Oh, fuck. We're in the mines? This is Ground Zero. This is the worst place to be.
Ground Zero. Welcome.
We have to go back to the source.
Oh, God. What is that? Brian grunts and stares to pull me into the opening, but I pull back. Brian yanks me hard, and it feels like he almost dislocates my shoulder. I yelp loudly, "Shut up." Brian hisses at me, and he turns sideways to better fit into the tunnel. "It's the mine, you idiot." "What?" I look back at the opening back toward Echo and gently illuminated by moonlight. I thought it was sealed. It is. This is the back entrance. Duke told me about it years ago. Said his family had known about it for decades. We push through for a while until we come to another tunnel. This one twice as wide as the one we were just in. It branches to the left and the right. Brian stands for a moment, inhaling deeply as he looks around. Hang on. It's been a while. I can't help myself but blurting out, "You don't know where to go." Expecting to hit me or something, but he ignores me. Finally, he pulls me to the left. I think he knows exactly where he's going. He said that he's too big to get to whatever it is he needs. He pulls me to the left. The idea of being trapped here with Brian lost in a mine is more terrifying than anything that's happened in this town so far. The air is so musty and dry, I feel like coughing and sneezing at the same time, but I try to hold it in so I don't upset Brian. We walk for another 10 minutes or so, taking a few more turns. I try to memorize the route in case I'm able to break free, but after 5 or so branches, I realize I can't remember the second or third. Brian suddenly speaks up, nearly making me jump in the darkness. After a while, I stop seeing aliens. His grip is tight, and I can feel that circulation to my paw cut off. It's like it's just a mass of pins and needles at this point. Now I just see people. kind of people. People you know? I try to keep Brian talking while I think. At some point, he's gonna have to let go of me again, and it's then that I'm going to have to make a run for it no matter what. Because he probably saw which direction we drove off, and he probably went to Leo to get the car. But at this point, I doubt they're going to be able to find us, at least not in time. We went to the mountains, probably through some back road that none of us even knew existed. Then Brian took me through hundreds of yards of desert to find a tiny opening behind some boulders. There's no way they're going to find me here. I'm on my own. I see this one person, but the person changes every now and then. Brian pauses, looking into the narrow opening in the tunnel wall, even more narrow than the first passage. Depending on who it is, depending on who it was the last knew. Before I can figure out what he meant by that, I'm shoved hard into, forced to enter a passage in front of Brian. It's just wide enough that I could walk straight at my shoulders, nearly touching both sides. Brian, on the other hand, has to suck in and move sideways, grunting and cursing, making all kinds of noises. Brian let go of me as he tries to pull himself through, though he keeps knocking into me to send me forward. I could try to escape, but I have a feeling that doesn't exist ahead of me. In fact, it feels like I'm being trapped. I can't explain it, but I start to get the terrible feeling that something awful is waiting for me at the end of this passage. And then I start to smell something. It's old, almost covered up by dust and mustiness, but it's definitely there. Sweet and sick, something rotting. It feels like ice is poured down my back and I freeze, only to be given a shove from the bear behind me. I fall forward into a wider opening. The smell entombs me, and I know without looking, I'm surrounded by death. I lay on the floor, not moving, listening to Brian as he tries to squeeze through the opening. I can remember years ago, when I was maybe 12, walking along a dirt road home after hanging out with Carl. On the side of the road, I saw some roadkill, and just as I passed by, I could see white maggots writhing through the fur. The smell of that single moment was almost unbearable, and I gagged and ran past. And while the odor in here is a bit more faint, it's almost exactly the same. I hear Brian finally shift free from the exit, and he shines the light back down on me.
And welcome to actual Ground Zero, the Ground Zero, where it all started.
I know I should run. I know I need to get the fuck out of here. I know I should be fighting like hell because I know what's coming. Is this what it's like for people who get kidnapped or murdered? People wondered why they didn't fight harder or run when they had the chance. I should have ran the second we stopped in the truck, but right now it's like I'm stuck in ice. My frantic thoughts are interrupted as Brian grasps me by the back of the shirt and pulls me back up to my feet. I'm not able to stand and just sort of crumble down next to him. The bear grunts and just drags me along into the little opening that we're in, dropping me against the wall. As Brian fumbles with the flashlight, I get a glimpse of my surroundings. Small, maybe about 15 feet long and 10 feet wide. It's narrow enough that Brian takes up most of the space, and I'd be hard-pressed to get past him. I draw my knees up to my chest and hug them, feeling numb. Oh, boy.
Oh!
Got a connection lost. Hold on. I have to click off this really quick. Okay, there we go.
God, you're such a useless piece of shit.
I watch Brian lean over something against the wall. It looks like two long polished pieces of wood. Brian tips the flashlight down, and I see that those pieces of wood are attached to a shovel and a pickaxe. Brian grabs the pickaxe, and for a heart-stopping moment, I think he's going to turn to me. But instead, he reaches into his pocket and pulls out something small and rectangular. Not until he opens it and shines the flashlight on it that I see some kind of small notebook. The bear looks at the notebook and then back up at the little cave we're in. The silence is almost unbearable, and I feel the need to say something, if only to fill that silence. What are you doing?
You know exactly what he's doing.
Brian ignores me as he continues to search for something. I whimper softly in the back of my throat. Please.
About to be murdered and you just beg like a little bitch.
Shut up! I can't help it as Can't help it as I hiss through my teeth at that goddamn voice. I don't need to hear it, especially now. Brand stiffens and turns around.
What?
I shake my head, squinting, unable to see. The face of the bear turns the light on me. Nothing, I just...
No,
you were talking to something. Did you see someone? No, I don't know. I shut my eyes against the light, only to see blood red. Brand chuckles, and my vision goes back to black as he takes the light off me.
Oh, it's the same way as you. Let me tell you something, though. Ignoring it ain't gonna make it go away.
Brian finally stops scanning the ground and crouches down. It takes me a moment to realize what he's looking at until he reaches down and picks it up.
A smooth stone.
Brian looks at it for a moment, thinking. Then he drops it off to the side and looks back down at his book.
Daniel, 19. There it. It was the smallest stone. Could be enough.
Brian shines the light down at the ground for a moment, then seems to make up his mind as he sets the butt of the flashlight to the ground. It brightly lights up the ceiling, leaving us in the dim yellow glow. Brian eyes me for a moment, positioning himself so he can watch me for a while, also doing his work. Crouching over, Brian starts breaking through the hard surface of the dirt with the pickaxe, grunting with each stroke. He can only do little short swings, the ceiling too low for Brian to even stand up straight. At this point, the smell of Brian has almost overwhelmed the stench of death. Jesus! I guess it's one of the few things I don't mind his smell covering up.
Why aren't you at least trying to escape?
Because he's in the way.
Because you're a coward.
The fuck are you even talking to me now? I thought you left.
I never left. You know that. You felt me even after you left the town.
I shouldn't have come back.
Probably not.
I'm going insane.
Brings back memories of my old life.
Going insane, it's bringing back all of my old demons.
No, I think it's because you're in the mind. I think you figured out that it's the source of everything, haven't you?
The voice I've been trying to ignore all week has changed. It's not vague or insidious anymore. It's more natural. Like a real person. More like what I used to hear when I was a kid.
Well, I was a real person. Sometimes I even doubt I am that person. Oh, no!
You did that in the voice.
I know, I'm sorry, but fuck! I think I know who we're talking to. It chuckles and I feel the back of my brain itch.
More like a... what do you call it? A simulation?
It waits for an answer, but I don't want to talk to it.
Oh, stop pretending I'm not here. You can feel me. You felt me looking over your shoulder since you got here.
I let my head thump against my knees, closing my eyes.
Well, really, ever since Sydney.
Just ignore it.
But I can understand. Even I feel as though something is controlling me. It's the oddest thing.
Hey! I set my head up, jumping as I find the bear staring right at me. The hell are you mumbling? Nothing. Brian chuckles again and reaches across the wall, grabbing the shovel. He starts digging up the loose patch of dirt in front of him. Yeah. Keep it to yourself, I guess. But like I said, you ain't the only one. Brian gestures behind them with a thumb toward the ground. I look and see nothing except a few stones on the ground. After Rachel back there, things got way, way worse than aliens for me. I saw her at night, crawling on my ceiling, peeking out under my bed, staring at me from my window. Brian grunts as he digs the shovel deep, then lifts, turning a pile of dirt out to the side. So the Duke drove him crazy, turned him into a speed addict. Not that I mind. He was always my most reliable customer. You mean Brian's been the... No, he actually is the dealer, and he's just been a bitch to Duke this entire time?
Yep.
Oh, my God. You're a... Okay, I'm not gonna... You need to keep going. The sick, sweet smell starts to grow again, and it's starting to become overpowering. I feel like I should keep talking, get him comfortable, and buy myself more time.
Should you, though?
Who's Rachel? Duke's wife. I try to remember what I know about Duke's marriage, aside from the fact that he isn't married anymore. I realize that I remember Rachel, but just barely. She was only around a while I was in grade school and was pretty nice as far as I can remember. Didn't he divorce her? Brian shrugs as he stops digging, resting on the handle. I guess he sort of did. But I mean, she was dead by then. They wanted my stuff but didn't have the money, so I cut him a deal to fuck for the drugs instead. I mean, I can say I like bitches at all, no one would mind it, but she let me go way farther than Duke ever did, so I meant I fucked around with her. It's not hard for me to picture exactly what that fucking was. Then one day, I guess I went too far. She died and we buried her right there. Brian points more specifically at the rock sitting against the other side of the wall. You buried her in the fucking pet cemetery! You guys are fucking idiots! The big bear starts to dig again more vigorously, lengthening the patch he's working on, but I didn't see her until right after I buried her, maybe a week later. The bear shakes his head and laughs mockingly. I think that stopped me from doing it again, but you know, when the last breath came out of her and she sort of shuddered on the table, Brian glances up at me. My load without even touching it. Maybe wonder how good it could be with a guy that was that good with the bitch.
You want him to keep talking?
Brian pauses in his sudden spurt of digging, looks up again. I have a feeling my mic didn't pick that up, but whatever.
I did.
Okay, sweet. Probably pondering why I'm telling you this, thinking I'm crazy, but I don't know. Feels good to tell someone. Feel like my own therapy otter. God damn it. The bear looks back down at the hole. Why am I laughing at that? The smell coming out of it is so overpowering I'm on the verge of gagging again. I don't see her anymore, though. It changes with each one.
7 stones.
And it probably changed again. And with that, the bear comes at me. The space is small, and it only takes him 2 steps. I skim and cover my face.
Coward.
And I try to fold into the light. I try to fold up into as tight a ball as I can, but before I know it, Brian has me by the back of the shirt. He dragged me over until I'm kneeling next to the hole. I can see it's definitely a grave now.
You already knew.
Because I can see the bones poking through the dirt, the bits of blue and white cloth that were its clothes.
You mean Daniel, the 19-year-old ferret?
Just, I feel like me telling this all to you and me being nice to you so far, maybe don't come back after me, just move on. I feel Brian move around behind me, then press something cold into the back of my head, a gun. Guess Brian probably had plenty of those. I'm doing the town good after all. How? I've let out my mind racing, trying to think of something, anything to get me out of this. Brian does pause though. How what? How is this helping anyone? Why are you doing this? A few seconds go by and I'm sure I'm about to hear the crack of the pistol is the last thing I'll ever hear. Then Brian sighs. Again, I feel like I should tell you everything. So, you know, you don't have to come back and fuck with me. But Duke, he said this all started when you came back. I told you I have no idea why. My voice raises in pitch as I start to panic. Duke has already tried to kill me, even after we tried to convince him I had nothing to do with any of this.
Not any of this? Are you sure of that?
I feel Brian set his feet behind me, and I can picture him getting ready to pull the trigger. I'm going to die.
This keeps happening, doesn't it? This hysteria?
I'm sorry. Remember this for the good of the town.
To me, it's like the town holds its breath, letting all the evil build up until it has to let it all out in one big go.
Oh, wait. Let me check something really quick.
Oh, jeez.
Sorry. I just want to make sure. Okay, never mind, we're fine.
Did we get that last line?
Hold on. And you brought a lot of guilt and evil with you back to this town. Maybe that was enough to push it over the edge again.
That's easy.
So in a way, it is your fault, isn't it?
My eyes are watering. I don't know if it's from Brian's grip in my fur or if I'm crying. Help me. I say it to you. look to the right?
Yep.
I glance to my right and see something standing in the entrance to our little hollow. It's faint either because of the dim lighting or because the thing itself isn't quite opaque. It's tall white. It's Socket Man!
Oh no!
And gangly. It's tall white and gangly, and its long fingers nearly touch the ground. Its face is heart-shaped, the whiteness of it interrupted by massive shiny black eyes in its face. It stands there motionless, watching us. I stare back open mouth. Brian must have taken notice because the next thing I know, the bear squeals. It's so loud and high-pitched, I wince. Brian lets me go as the thing moves. It seems to lean forward and glide towards us, but the gliding is stilted, like a film with half seconds missing from it. It flickers, seeming to turn transparent as it grows closer, the white fading to pink, then bright red. Oh my god, it's the same creature!
Mm-hmm.
For a brief second before reverting. Wait, so Jen has been seeing this thing?
Yep.
I'm frozen, kneeling as I watch. Since her childhood, what the fuck? Brian backs away and promptly steps on the flashlight. The light careens sideways, and I look over to see Brian's foot slip on the cylindrical flashlight before his rump comes down hard on top of it. All light is extinguished. I can't see the thing or Brian now. I hear him, though, as he lets out another screech of pure fear like a wounded animal. I hear something else, too. A voice also high-pitched babbling something fast and senseless. It's like a tape recorder being rewound. Brian's screeching impossibly turns up a notch, and I instinctively move forward away from the horrible sounds, and I pitch forward into the hole. The smell engulfs me, and I feel the hard, knobbly things in the dirt around me. Where are you going? Just taking a back road. But we're leaving the city. Yeah, well, I live outside the city. You didn't tell me that. Go back to the club. Alright, pull the fuck over, let me out. I said, pull over. The fuck is the lock? He was not doing that. Hey, get off me! I gasp and scramble out the grave, gagging uncontrollably. Oh my god! Is Brian a serial killer rapist?
Well, remember, there was a stone for that one girl's grave, and how many did they say there were in that
there
room?
There were seven, and we're experiencing their memories.
Yeah.
I'm out again, curl up on my side, drawing in my knees again. The horrible screeching, bizarre babbling language continues, though it sounds from Brian are more ragged now. Occasionally the room flashes with light as Brian chips around, but I face the wall, not wanting to look.
Get up.
I curl tighter, just waiting, hoping that I wake up.
You sniveling little shit, get up!
Press my face into the dirt.
Trust me, there's far worse out there, and it's coming for you unless you get up and get out.
I've given up. Get up, Chase. Yes. You force yourself onto your hands and knees and start crawling in the direction of the exit. The flashlight continues to be rolled around, giving you a glimpse of where you're going. The sounds from Brian have stopped. Now it's just the mechanical gibberish that seems to be growing in pitch and speed. But you don't look back. You don't need to see that. The otter is already broken enough. Soon you're crawling through the exit, and the cacophony behind you is immediately muted. It becomes more and more faint until it almost disappears as you come out the other side. Once you're free, you stand up in the comparatively fresh, cool air, the main tunnel. You remember this place. You also know the tunnels like the back of your hand.
Ace does not remember this. This isn't him.
This is...
Yeah, it's all in the second person right now, I think.
Yeah. It's pitch black, but you feel along the walls. You should be able to find your way out. So Chase is probably experiencing the memories of someone
Maybe.
That died here and got
yeah,
out?
Yeah.
Or knows...
Out.
No, died here, but knows the way. You head to the right down toward the end of the main tunnel with your right hand dragging along the wall. Then you feel an opening with your hand. You take a left, then another right. And finally, the final right takes you out back the exit. Nick had drilled the directions in your head far too many times for you to... Red eyes appear at the end of the tunnel, at the end of the last stretch. You freeze and observe. Things in the mines can hurt you. Well, things in the mines can hurt you far worse than things outside. Bran had just experienced that. These are all the guys from the smoke room, isn't it?
Nikolai.
But that's you're not my badger. Sure. That's your badger. Is yeah. this one of the otter's demons, or no? It's something else. Something you're not quite seeing correctly.
What? Did we figure something out? I'm confused.
There's a prequel story called The Smoke Room that tells what happened, why Echo is the way it is, but it's very porny.
Right. Is this the story of the first guy that died in the mine?
Maybe. A friend, the lizard, he's warped. Oh my god, I've never been so happy to see you in my entire life! Yeah. You fucking asshole! What the fuck are you doing here? I slumped to my knees, kicking uncontrollably as Flynn shines a light down on me. Fuck, Chase, come on, let's go. Sorry, that's you.
You're good.
Come on,
Flynn yanks me to my feet, and the next thing I know, I'm stumbling after him, out of the mine and out of what I'm now completely convinced is hell. I sit in the passenger seat of Flynn's truck, feeling numb. I choose to stare out the window, watching the desert rush by as Flynn tries to ask me questions.
Where's the bear?
I shake my head.
Is he still in the mine?
I think so.
What happened?
I don't know. It feels strange being back out here. While everything is definitely fucked up and strange out here in Echo, at least it makes some sense. The mine is completely different. It's chaos. That's the word. Chaos. What? How did you find me? I look back at Flynn and see he's staring at me closely, barely keeping an eye on the road.
I went to Leo's house, found all of you guys there, except you, of course.
Just waiting? I don't know how to feel about the idea that all my friends were sitting around while a serial killer had kidnapped me. Of course, none of us really knew Brian was a serial killer.
Well, a lot was going on. Kutsu, that raccoon, is the one that you told me you were missing. Leo, on the other hand, said you were fine, and he saw you around the house.
Oh my fucking god! What? Flynn shrugs.
I have no fucking clue, but he was practically holding everyone hostage and wouldn't give the keys up, so I had to take my own truck out of there.
Is everyone okay?
Hopefully. Yeah, you have a voice on. Jenna said she'd try and keep him calm while I came and look for you.
How did you know I was in the mine?
You still got the voice on.
You have the voice on. Well, at least it was the trauma medic. It's all good.
I drove up the
canyon since that's basically the only place he could go. I saw he parked and he taking you in there.
But how do you know about the back entrance? Flynn smirks as we come out of the Curve Echo Canyon. Was it out of the Curve Echo Canyon onto the straight road to Echo?
Does it really matter? Either way, I know a lot about the town.
Watch Flynn for a while until he finally glances back at me.
What?
Where the hell have you been these past few days?
Oh, in the town hall, managing stuff.
Oh yeah, he works there, huh?
Yeah.
Stuff?
Like, everything going on. I tried to find you guys at the hotel at Carl's house, but I didn't see anyone. I assumed you tried to leave.
That answer is far more satisfactory, but I have no energy to dig deeper. So, are we going back?
Yep.
Then what?
Well, they're saying something about a train, so I assume we try to get out that way. Sounds like you already found out you can't drive out.
Yeah. Under the road to Leo's house as I watch the house draw close, I can't help the growing sense of dread in the pit of my stomach. As soon as we step through the doorway, I'm engulfed in a combination of beige, gray, black, and white fur. I'm surrounded by my friends. Jenna, Carl, Kudzu all talking at once, ask me how I am, what happened, if I'm okay. Lynn puts his hands up.
Guys, let him breathe. I don't think he's up for talking too much.
I had a feeling he was just going to walk in on this, too.
Yeah.
It's fucking Flynn. Why wouldn't he? Jenna and Carl step back, but Kudzu doesn't. He's got a hand on my shoulder, gripping it like he doesn't think I'm real.
Hey, I'm sorry. I should have been more careful. I should have let you piss on my fucking carpet or something.
Takes me a second to realize what he's talking about. The thing that got me into Brian's trap in the first place. It makes me laugh a bit at how earnest Kudzu looks compared to what just came out of his mouth. I also realize that I want to hug him really, really badly, so I do. Feel the raccoon stiffen up for a moment, then the hug back. It feels so fucking good to be in the arms of someone I trust, and it seems to break through the numbness that I'm feeling, at least for a little bit. Girl seems to take that as an invitation for a hug as well, and Jenna joins in. I don't mind, and I wish I could stay like this forever. Actually, I just wish this all hadn't happened in the first place. Comes to an end eventually, and Kudzu is the last to draw back. I'm about to ask where TG is when I see Leo. Bob stands at the entrance of the hallway, his eyes on me and Kudzu. He's got a pillow on one paw, and his shirt is hitched over his stomach a bit, like he just pulled it on.
What are you doing?
The room goes quiet, and the mood immediately changes. Now Jen and Kudzu look all weary. No one says anything. I clear my throat. I'm back. Brian took me to. Leo frowns.
Back? No, you were in my room and asked for a pillow. We were...
Leo's glare turns on Kudzu.
Have they been telling you to say this?
Leo, no. Look at my former boyfriend's eyes is completely alien to me. I've never seen that look out from him before. I guess I knew that the town or whatever all this is has gotten to him, but not completely taken him. Now I'm not so sure. Kudzu stands next to me, his shoulder in front of mine. His eyes... Leo eyes him again before turning back to me.
Ace, come here.
I don't move. The room is completely silent.
Chase, I said come here.
Leo, what,
Leo, what the hell?
Leo ignores Flynn, his steely eyes on mine. The feeling of coming to a safe place is completely gone now. Echo has seeped into every part of my life, it seems. But I don't move, and neither does Kudzu. Leo doesn't seem to know what to do. His face transforms from anger to confusion.
Jula, you were just in the bedroom with me. Tell me.
Leo trails off. I was in the mine, Leo, with Brian. Leo stares. The sound drags on until a soft clicking comes from the kitchen. Everyone looks at TJ, emerges, staring at us all with sad, lost eyes. TJ, what is it?
There's another train coming.
Oh, good. Thank you for watching, TJ. I'm not sure if Jenna is relieved because our ride out is coming or it's because it can distract us from the whole Leo situation. I'll move at once, squeezing past Leo to the backyard. He watches me pass dumbfounded. Oh, he's fucking gone. TJ's right. In the distance. Oh, God, please. Let this be the end. Let this be the train. We all have everyone here. Why wouldn't it be? In the distance, I can see the lights on the train slowly winding its way towards us. At this point, down. At this point, down is just breaking. Somehow, it's only been one night, even though it feels like it's been several weeks. All right.
For whatever reason, that train is moving pretty fucking slow. We should just be able to hop on it.
The train wails in the distance again, much closer now.
I thought I was going to have to drive alongside it with all of you in the truck, but honestly.
The train does seem to be moving pretty slow. As I get closer, I realize that it's not exactly going to be a jog to run alongside it. I might be able to catch up at full sprint.
All right, here's what we're going to do. I'll get on first, along with Kudzu. We're going to pull the rest of you on, all right?
Carl fidgets nervously. I don't know if I could run that fast.
You will. Now.
I feel a pollen on my shoulder and turn me around. It's Leo.
Hey.
Hey, what is it? I look back at Flynn, wanting to hear what he's saying.
Listen to me. Everything you said at the house, did you mean it?
Huh? What did I say? Leo looks impatient.
What you said about loving me and wanting to be with me forever, you meant that, right?
Excuse me? What? The train is approaching. We have maybe a minute.
What the fuck? Why are you acting like you don't fucking remember?
Leo bristles, teeth bared, arrows narrowing. Oh my God, Leo, let's get out of here first. I start to back away towards the others as they continue to discuss jumping the train.
No.
Excuse me? Leo grabs my shoulder, looking right in the eye. He makes an effort to calm down, closing his eyes a moment before opening them.
Then tell me now, are you going to stay with me when this is all over?
Oh my fucking God. Can we talk about this when we get on the train?
No, I want to know before.
I see Kudzu looking at us, and it looks like he's about to head over.
Just tell me the truth. That's all I want. And here's the big option.
Oh my God. So I have had to really think about a lot of the choices I've made in this game. Because it's so like,
one.
No, this game has thrown me a fucking bone and presented me with the easiest choice I've ever had to make in my entire life.
Choose it.
Hold on.
Jesus.
I need to fucking play the clip of my before I do it. Yo, Zai's boring the mine as I look back at him. Now isn't the time for this. In fact, it was absolutely the worst time for something like this. Hold on, let me click on OBS, make sure this is fine. But looking at him, I could tell this is the only time for Leo. No, Leo. Leo's eyes widen and he leans his head back just slightly at the time, taking a step back. It's like I physically pushed him. After everything that's happened, I just can't. Leo seems frozen watching me, his arms hanging loosely at his sides. I hear the crunch of gravel next to me as Kutsu's by my side.
Come on, we're going now.
Leo's hand moves then to his waistband.
Gun.
I have a moment to see him lift a gun from under his shirt, his eyes on Kutsu. Body moves automatically, stepping in front of the raccoon, raising my hands up to my chest defensively. Leo's already frozen his motion, though. Gun in front of his stomach still pointed down to the ground as he stares past me.
What the fuck?
Leo Kutsu grabbed my arm from behind me, his grip so tight that it's painful. But I keep my eyes on Leo, waiting and watching to see what direction the gun might go in. But then it drops. First, his arm hangs loosely by his side once more, then the gun, which clatters to the gravel below. I flinch, expecting it to go off. It doesn't. Instead, my ears are filled with the sound of the arriving train. Leo's eyes are back to mine, and I watch his tears start to spill out. Come on, Leo, we have to get out of here. Kutsu pulls me back, and I turn away from Leo and the town of Echo as I rejoin the rest of the group.
Run!
Blaine shoves Carl toward the forward, and the ram takes off alongside the rails, looking over his shoulder at the train. The next thing I know, we're all running after Carl as the train catches up. I look back. Blaine waves both arms at the locomotive as it whizzes past, but if there's a reaction from the driver, I don't see it. I have just enough time to read the letters on the side of the engine, Prescott Railway, before moving past down the tracks. I realize that the train is quite short, maybe only 5 cars in all? Yeah, we don't have many chances.
Kutsu!
Blaine points at the caboose and starts running beside it. Next, the two little steps that drop down at the very end of from the platform. Gracefully, the lizard jumps, landing his feet on the steps as his hands scramble for some kind of purchase. He finds it and pulls himself in, and the next second he's reaching out, holding onto a handle on the caboose, and he grabs one of Kutsu's paws. With much more ease than Flynn had, Kutsu jumps up onto the steps and pulls himself onto the platform. I pass Carl at this point, the ram already losing steam. He calls out for me in a hoarse, ragged voice. Shit, I'm not gonna make. Flynn grabs the ram as they pass, and Carl hop skips on the uneven gravel for a horrifying moment. I think he's gonna fall, but Kutsu leans in and snatches him up as well, practically lifting Carl onto the platform. Jenna, who's right beside me, is next, reaching out a paw toward Flynn. He grabs it, and Jenna easily jumps on over the two steps. I think it's my turn next, but TJ slows down abruptly, and I move to the side to make room for him. Flynn grabs his arm. TJ hesitates several times before Kutsu gets a grip on him as well, and he's able to step up onto the first step. It's then I realize that the train is picking up speed, and I'm starting to slow down. I move beside the caboose, seeing Flynn's outstretched hand. Now that I'm next to it, I can see how terrifying this is. The wheels clack loudly in my ears, and I have no idea what's going to lift one, how I'm going to lift one leg while keeping up this speed. But I get a grasp on Flynn's hand, and I see Kutsu's paw reaching out as well. The train's going way too fast now, and I know I only have one chance at this. I pull down my hands and lift my feet up to the land on the last step. But as my feet make contact, relief floods through me. I can't help myself but grin as I pull myself up the steps. I don't know if we're safe or this whole plan is going to work, but we carried it out somehow, and that feels good for once. Something went finally right. Yeah. And you know what's great about this? It wasn't organized by Leo.
Leo had nothing to do with it.
Then I remember Leo and look back, expecting him to be running next to the train. Instead, all I see is brush and gravel rushing past. I look back toward the town, and I think I can make out a small figure in the distance. Exactly where I'd left them.
Where the hell is Leo?
I stay silent, but Flynn follows my gaze out toward the desert.
Shit.
At that moment, I'm not sure what I should feel. Probably relief. But what I do feel is an incredible wave of sadness, like a physical wave smashing into my body. Probably the same thing Leo felt when I told him. Some part of me knows that this shouldn't matter right now. All that matters is that we might have just escaped with our lives. But leaving Leo behind? Someone I'd known most of my life. Someone who'd protected me, been a friend to me, getting me through the worst parts of my life. Someone who'd always emphasize togetherness and family, who'd always vowed to protect and stand by my side. That very same person had just chosen to stay behind. Well, we were the ones leaving, he's the one that decided to leave us. And that solitary figure grows smaller and smaller. That idea hurts more than anything else right now. After seeing Janice get murdered, after being tortured by Brian, after nearly being murdered in the mine, the separation from my best friend is the knife being twisted into my chest. I sink to my knees, holding onto the railing, wondering if I should have stayed behind. Because the Leo I'd just been with wasn't the Leo I really knew. He needed help, and I just abandoned him. Ah, we're two for two. I should have stayed behind. Hot tears spill over my cheeks as I stare at the metal platform. Oh, that's me, though.
Yeah, there's two voices here. I'll do the secondary if you want me to.
No, that's fine, I can do this.
Ugh. Let it all out.
Okay.
Fuck you.
We see the words under my breath, but there's more rage behind them than anything I've ever said in my life. And they're meant for Echo. Fuck you for killing this.
Fuck you for hurting William.
Fuck you.
Fuck you for hurting Cliff.
Fuck you for what's buried in the mines.
Fuck you for hurting Nick.
Fuck you for twisting my friends into something they're not.
Fuck you for hurting Cynthia and Murdoch.
Fuck you for
ruining my life.
I sit there on my knees sobbing hard, like I'm crying for two people at once. I can't see Leo anymore, but the thought of him alone and probably hurting like me is too much. I don't know how long I cry for, but it feels like a long time. After a while, I feel a paw on my shoulder. I imagine the rest of my friends standing there staring at me, but when I turn my head, it's only Kutsu. Raccoon is crouched next to me, his head turned towards me. I look, a look that can only be described as understanding on his face. In a bit of a daze, I rub my face on my shoulder to clear my vision. Sorry.
Don't be.
He says it automatically as he rubs my shoulder gently.
Do you want to get up? The rest of them are inside.
I stay crouched for a moment, watching the blur of train tracks in front of me as we continue through the desert. Give me a sec. My nose is all stuffy, so my voice comes outclogged. The tiny lights of Echo on the endless expanse of the desert get smaller and smaller, and so too does the feeling of tension in my chest. And with the tension goes the sad, angry presence in my head. It key goes quiet again. Makes me feel a bit better. Each time I think about Leo, that knife gets a little deeper. Kutsu nods and squeezes my shoulder. After a few moments of silence, he speaks.
You know, that's someone I lost a few years ago.
I wipe my eyes and begin to nod.
He was my boyfriend.
I keep silent as I stand, Jack's almost hypnotized. A strange feeling of wanting to jump tickles at the back of my brain and fades slowly.
One night we were walking along like we usually did, and we got mugged. We should have just given him everything. But my boyfriend, of course, stepped forward and confronted the guy and got shot.
Mm. I glance back at their crew with no idea what to say. He shakes his head like he's coming out of a dream.
And I'm just saying that I'm here. I might know what this feeling's like, you know?
I cough a little to clear my throat. I mean, he didn't die. It's his shrugs.
Breaking up can feel like that sometimes.
It's a lot more than that. It was all of that. Wave in the direction of the town. It just feels like I lost him right when he got away.
We're gonna get people to get back for him.
Yeah. I let a big breath before slowly standing up, my knees popping as I do. It just stands with me and I lean against the railing, choosing not to look out at the town. After a moment, I turn to face Kudzu, and then I'm hugging him. There's no hesitation this time. He hugs back. I let myself lean into him, letting him support me, feeling the fur of his neck poke through mine. I stay like that for a good 5 minutes, vibrating along the train. Finally, I pull back. All right. We should probably go in. I don't think it's all that safe out here anyway. Without letting go of me, Kudzu opens the door and guides me inside. My friends are sitting in little seats in the dark, sweating along with the train's movements. Carl sits closest to us as he looks up at the sound of the door. Hey, Chase. Are you okay? I laugh. No. Carl smiles sadly. Yeah. Sorry. You're fine. See Jen and TJ together on a seat further along the wall, and Flynn sits opposite them. Further still, a small shape sits leaning against the opposite of the end of the caboose, curled up on his seat. It's Clint.
Hey.
But occasionally, I'm kind of glad he got out.
Yeah.
Flynn occasionally glances at him, but the polecat doesn't seem interested in coming closer to us. Kudzu guides me to sit next to Carl, and I make room so that the raccoon can sit next to me. So, where do you think we're going? I feel Carl twitching against me as he sits there hunched over. Anywhere's better. As long as it's not hell, I guess. I guess. Kudzu's arm goes around my shoulders automatically, and we sit in silence for what feels like a long, long time. And I don't mind it. I wouldn't mind if this was the rest of my life, honestly. For the first time in several days, I feel calm and safe. Soon enough, though, the darkness of the caboose is illuminated with occasional flashes of light. Flynn looks out the window.
Peyton.
The grating screech, the train starts slowing down. I'm a little surprised. I guess I thought the train wasn't even real and it would just go on forever. But now it comes to a slow, stuttering stop. We all sit in the dark, quiet, listening, and then Flynn opens up the door. Soft orange light spills inside. The hell? Out of the doorway, I see rows of train tracks occupied with other boxcars. Someone moves into view. It's an older-looking fox in overalls. He stares at us. We're aliens. Where the hell did he come from? A moment of silence goes before Flynn clears his throat.
We're from Echo.
Oh, my God.
I told you.
Oh, Saturday. Oh, another day.
Yeah, but you know what? It's a new day. Oh, boy. It feels, this looks familiar.
It's a time loop, everybody. Let's play again.
Yeah, Mom, I'll call you in an hour. No, I'm not. No, we're not staying the night. I promise. Wow, Mom. All right, I swear. I love you too. Bye. I hang up and drop my paw into my lap, sighing loudly. Kudzu laughs.
Everything okay?
I rub my eyes. Yeah, I guess she's just worried, obviously. Kudzu reaches over and sets his paw on my knee, squeezing briefly before returning it to the steering wheel.
I can still turn back, you know?
I take in another breath and hold it. It's tempting. It might be a better idea just to let the past die, but now that I'm leaving the area for good, I want to see it one more time. The town and Leo. I let the breath out.
Nah, I need to do this. I've thought about it for so damn long, and there's no way I'd forgive myself for backing out now. I need closure.
All right, but if he gets weird at all, I'm taking you the hell out of there.
He won't. He's back to normal, as much as any of us can be anyway. But I told him that it's only going to be a little bit, that we're just driving through. I look over at him. He wants to stay in the car.
He's planning to, unless you're planning on going inside.
No, I'll stay outside.
Alright, but I'll be watching in case you two try anything.
Yeah, right. It's been 2 years. Oh, we're 2 years older!
That's not very long.
It's not. He put his hand on our knee. We dating now? Did we get our secret route?
Did we truly get the goodest ending?
That's not very long. Yeah. Hey, I know Leo. He's not the person we last saw.
Yeah, I know.
I feel my stomach tighten as I suddenly realize we're driving past the lake into Main Street. Yeah, yeah. Kind of funny. Going through multiple, seeing all the situations you survived thanks to Kudzu. Completely abandoned, but then we pass the motel. The windows are all boarded up, and the parking lot is filled with more cracks than I remember, but I'm hit with a wave of familiarity all the same. Standing in the parking lot are two people. Pointing at the motel is a large black bear, and in front of the stands a canine with some kind of video camera. Oh, shit, are those the guys? Yo! Fuck, I gotta play that game next!
Wait, what? What's that from?
So Arches. It is a bear and a small canine, which is the main characters in the thing after this one called Arches.
So Arches is after the Mass Hysteria Echo story.
Yeah.
All right.
But we got a new set of boyfriends, and
we'll get to that later.
Kudzu snorts, but doesn't say anything. At first, I feel a spark of anger at them. We're probably seeing the whole thing as a morbidly fun adventure. Oh yeah, that's definitely them. Not even having the slightest idea of what sort of hell the town went through. And then I remember that I'd done the same thing. Granted, it was many more years removed, but still the same. We turn onto Leo Street and my stomach tightens further. Kudzu glances at me.
Can I get a kiss before you talk to your
yes! He's our boyfriend! We fucking did it! We fucking beat this fucking town! Fuck you, Echo! We got something good!
We have truly won.
Come on, you're almost there.
Okay, eyes on the road. Kudzu leans over very deliberately, keeping his eyes on the road as he tries to turn his face toward me. Give him a quick peck on the side of the muzzle and he laughs. I try to laugh as well, but it gets caught in my throat as I see that old house. Oh god, so many bad memories there. And they're waiting in the driveway is Leo. He's not wearing the bracelet!
Not wearing the bracelet.
Leo cheerfully greets me as I open my door. Catches me off guard a little bit, his mood being so different from mine. Hey Leo, what's up? As his paws shoved in his pockets but still manages to shrug.
Not much. You?
Not much. Leo ducks his head and looks in at Kudzu.
Hey, Kud, you alright?
Kudzu awkwardly answers from behind me.
Yeah, I'm okay.
There's a moment of silence as I try to think of what to say or do. I kind of expected Leo just to meet me outside.
Did you want to come in for a beer or something?
God, no! I mean, sorry, we're busy.
I'm actually driving for the next couple hours.
Yeah, we were just stopping by for a minute.
Ah, okay.
Leo's smile falters a bit. Then he shrugs again.
Want to go for a walk then? Stretch your legs.
I look back at Kudzu. He doesn't say anything. Doesn't give me a hint as to what he's thinking. He's leaving the decision up to me. Yeah, sure. Leo ducks his head again.
You want to come, Kud?
Kudzu hesitates and shakes his head.
Nah, you two go ahead. I prefer the AC. Alright, cool.
Feeling just a little tension between the two of them, I quickly jump out and shut my door. I look over at the rail yard, which is in full view of the car and point. Want to walk over there?
Sure.
So you've just been hanging out here for the past 2 years?
A little bit. Spend a lot of time with my parents. I'm moving back with them right now, actually.
Oh, thank God. Yes, please don't stay here. Don't! Oh, yeah?
Yeah, it sucks, but honestly, I can't stand all the vultures scavenging around for stories here.
Oh, God. Sounds like it, but at least you'll be around other people, right?
Yeah, it's officially a ghost town now, if you haven't noticed.
Fuck, that makes... I want to visit the ghost town in San Bernardino now.
Ooh. Yeah.
I look out over the rest of the town toward the motel and convenience store and all the tiny houses and trailers in between. Not a single person.
I actually visited Carl once in a while over the summer.
Theo nods up toward the mountains, and I see the big mansion sitting gently in the sunset. I'm glad collectively they're still keeping contact with each other. Like, if we don't talk for a long time, I could at least ask Carl or any of the others, like, hey, how's he doing?
Yeah.
Hey, that's cool. I hear he's doing pretty good at school right now. Oh my God, it is the good ending.
Are you going back to school?
I shrug my shoulders, walking up the train tracks and straddle the steel. Oh wait, what? Straddle the steel rails. Not in Pueblo, since we're moving up a couple of states, but probably eventually. A little conversation as we both go quiet. Look around, wondering this was the spot where we hopped the train. A train that turned out to be an old engine and caboose on its way to Peyton, where it was then transferred to a train museum. I'd been traveling at a gentle 10 miles per hour to keep from derailing off the old tracks, just slow enough for us to catch. It was the last three engines being transferred that night. No wonder the times were random. Just a few hours later, the emergency services went in and recovered whoever was left in town, including Leo. I still wonder if we even needed to hop the train, but I guess I was escaping more than just the town. Look back at Leo. Are you okay? Leo looks up, kicking around some rocks. Scratch my head vigorously, trying to think of how not to say the wrong thing. Have you been doing okay? Are you happy? Leo smiles.
Not really. Are you?
I think back to the past 2 years of nightmares and panic attacks of breaking down into tears out of nowhere. How just a few hours ago I dropped to the ground in a grocery store in Peyton because someone dropped a jar of jam. The kudzu had been there. Fuck, he's got PTSD.
Yep.
Well, but then again, who fucking doesn't after this all went down?
Exactly. Yeah. Like, that's...
But Kutsu had been there like always to help me back up. I'm managing. Oh, God. I can't.
Oh, God.
I'm not doing the thing. Yeah, I can't cope with this. It's a process.
That's good.
Are you managing? Leo chuckles.
I'm just living.
Are you getting help?
Like professional help?
Yeah.
No.
It can really help.
I like to do things on my own these days.
I guess there's some merit to that.
Character development, sort of.
Leo looks back toward the car, kids are barely visible through the windows. People can help. You don't have to do everything on your own.
I think it's best if I stay away from people for now.
I notice the anchor bracelet missing from Leo's wrist. I look down at the tracks. Listen, I'm sorry about everything that happened. I wish I could do things over, even before what happened here in Echo. He looks at me for a moment, a sad smile on his face.
The last 2 years have been hell for me. I cried myself to sleep every night thinking about you.
I feel my face flush with embarrassment and, for some reason, shame. Damn it! An actual appropriate song!
Yeah. But last month, for the first time, it stopped. I stopped thinking about you every hour. I stopped thinking about what you might be doing, about how he might be treating you, and whether or not you're thinking of me. Yeah, I still think about you sometimes, and when I do, I still cry. But now it hurts less. So yeah, I'm doing better, Chase.
Oh, well, that's good. I have no right to feel a little sad, but I do.
I'm sorry, Chase, for not protecting you the way I should have. Trying to control you into all that shady shit behind your back.
Oh my God, we're actually talking about our issues.
Whatever the fuck was in this town that made us all go crazy, I realized it twisted up my thinking. But those thoughts were always there. Echo just brought it up to the surface. So I'm a shitty person, and you made me realize that. And I'm sorry I brought you into it. Just know that I really did love you.
He looks over my shoulder and at the car again.
Anyway, you should get back to Kud. He'll take care, good care of you. And I hope you'll take care of him. Alright?
My mouth hangs open a little, but that snaps me back into reality. Yeah. Yeah, I'll do that. Start walking back to the car, but Leo doesn't follow me. I pause. Do you want my new number? We can talk now.
No.
Whoa, that's smart. No, that's good. This is very smart. We're making good decisions now.
Let's go.
The surprised look on my face makes me a laugh. It's a real laugh, kind of sad, kind of happy, but real.
That wouldn't be a good for either of us.
So we're just saying goodbye forever? A little knife in my heart starts twisting again. Leo shrugs.
You never know.
I stand there 10 feet away from my first boyfriend, my first kiss in this very rail yard. My best friend.
But hey, if you drive through Payton again, I'm always open to have another chat. Maybe you'll catch me in a better place.
I will. I say it immediately and Leo smiles at me. So I'll see you again someday.
I'll look forward to it.
All right. Bye then.
Goodbye, Chase.
I walk the rest of the distance to the car and open up the passenger door before getting in and sitting down. With the door still open, I look back one last time. Leo stands there, paws still jammed in his pockets, his fur lined with orange and gold light from the setting sun, highlighting his head fur like a halo. I take it in for a moment, then wave. He waves back. And with that, I close the door.
Enjoy the credit music. Remember Emo, the song I told you? Here you go. Enjoy.
Are they actually going to sing it?
You'll see.
Oh. So this was Chase and Leo's, like, song, right?
Love song. In the truck.
Oh, why are you showing me this picture? Oh, well, I guess we needed something for the good ending.
Yep.
Oh my god, I am a huge fucking mess right
well,
now.
I have to go.
Alright, thanks Matt, thanks for everything.
Yeah.
We'll do Carl's route and we'll better organize it. Oh shit, yeah, I know there's vocals.
This is called Blurry. It's by, just look it up on YouTube, you can read the lyrics. It's really, really good. It's, hey, this is Leo's theme. Yeah.
Okay. Alright, later. Thanks for everything, Matt. I owe you one.
All good.
Alright, so I want to bring up that This is Leo's song. Last night, before I got in the shower, I was going through my shower playlist. And this was made years ago. It was made during a time I got really into retrowave. Thanks to the new Retrowave YouTube channel. And one of the songs that debuted or that they posted while during that time I was following them. I still follow them, but there was a song called I Recall by, hold on, let me look it up. I want to say Robert Parker, but I could be wrong. Let me see. Because, like, I was listening to that song a lot last night. Where the hell are you? Yeah. Oh, sorry. Yeah. Robert Parker, I Recall. And I've heard this song many times. I really like that song. But after playing Echo and then listening to I Recall by Robert Parker, I was just like, wait a second. Because, like, the song's about someone who probably ended their relationship with their ex under really bad conditions, and it's just like, hey, give me another chance. And I was like going through the lyrics, the vocalist is just like, I know I did some awful things and I want to own up to them, and I'm like, oh my god, this song's Leo's theme. But like, despite the other stuff, and also, holy shit, that was an incredibly satisfying ending. Not even just the like, hey, we got a boyfriend out of all this, is that it just, we got to talk to Leo about all the terrible shit that we did to each other, and then even then, it's just like, we have the maturity and foresight to know that, like, hey, yeah, no, it'd be bad for me if we kept talking right now. So, holy crap, yeah, no, I got everything I wanted from this fucking path right here. Oh my god. Alright, and who are we doing next? We're doing Carl next.
Yep.
Oh, man. I don't know what to expect. Because I'm trying to think here. Because Matt told me that like every different character is a different type of horror.
Well, what was the horror we just had to deal with there?
I don't know. I've seen... It's not exactly a genre. Or maybe it is. There's a... let me click off really quick. Let me see. I need to check this out really quick. Let's see. Is this a genre? Let me see. There is like a... maybe? I want to say Leo's I don't know, his horror trope might have been abduction? Because there's some horror movies about abduction, but like, yeah. I'm trying to think, is that like a widely known like subgenre of horror? And I'm, it is. There's a lot of movies about abduction and being kidnapped. So that's what I'm guessing. But then also we had some fucking monster shit happen down, but Jenna has apparently been seeing Socket Man for a long time, so I'm under the impression that like maybe there's like a bit of creature supernatural monster in like all of them. But yeah, no, holy crap. Oh, that was... I didn't think the game would give me such emotional satisfaction with its ending. And like,
well, I thought we're still dealing with the whole voice in his head and like what happened with Sydney. So
we're probably gonna have to play more routes and piece that together. And maybe one of these particular routes will I don't know if it'll give us the answers we need, or just we're just gonna have to piece everything together for ourselves. Though that makes me wonder if the voice in Chase's head, because I thought maybe is that Sydney, but at the end, when we were saying fuck the town, he was saying names of characters from the smoke room, and that makes me wonder if that character was the protagonist from the smoke room.
So what's the what happens to smoke room again? Or are we gonna have to play that one as well at some point?
I don't think we are. So I thought about recording it and then finding some form of video editing software to just do highlights of it, because
well, we don't need to stream it.
But we will. Yeah, but we'll play it. Let me see. So the story of the smoke room is, you know, Echo during like its prime, when you know there were people there all working at the mines. The story follows Samuel. I think Samuel is... I think he's a puma or a mountain lion of some sort. He's definitely some sort of American like wildcat. Sam is a sex worker in the smoke room, which is a brothel that caters to... It's a gay brothel. They're all gigolos. But you know, during 1915, that was probably like hidden. That thing about it was probably like hidden. Like super well, like there's probably like passwords and shit you need to know if you want to order man from the smoke room. But yeah, no, the story follows Samuel and like, let's see, he apparently has done something and Echo isn't letting him forget. He just moved into Echo and he's already regretting it. But yeah, no, I don't know much about it other than like that it's horny. the smoke room's like a prequel story that sets up the really messed up shit that made this town go to hell. So yeah. Oh boy. Alright, well, let's quit and get that stream ending soon scene. My god, I am so... I'm tired, but also incredibly satisfied. I know we don't have the answers for Sydney, and we're probably, like I said, we're probably gonna have to piece those together and find the rest of, you know, gonna have to get those pieces and put it all together ourselves, but at the very least, like, all the characters I've actually started to care towards the end, you know, are in a much better place. Mm-hmm. You know, Carl's back to school. I don't know what the fuck. Well, Flynn was already working, so he probably still is. And then I wonder if Jenna stayed behind in Pueblo and is going to pursue her degree in experimental psychology, I think it was. But yeah.
I don't care what TJ does. I'm just happy he's not dead. Mm-hmm. Or insane, for that matter.
Oh my god. Yeah. Oh. So yeah, thanks for watching. If you like what you saw, be sure to give me a follow. I am a variety streamer. We are going to be playing more of this for sure. I am going to have to get the other routes. But, like, it's nice that we got the big one out of the way. And I left completely satisfied. So, yeah. If you like what you saw, give me a follow. I'm a variety streamer. All kinds of stuff. So hopefully one day I'll finish something that I start. And until next time, remember to stay healthy and stay hydrated. And fuck, man, talk to your loved ones. Don't keep your issues and whatnot bottled inside. Seek help. Don't be these people. Have a good one.